Hello and welcome to the Pong GDScript Basics series. In this episode, we will be taking a look at planning the Pong game. Godot Tutorials is not sponsored by or affiliated with the Godot game engine. Let's recap with the common project game development phases. First, you create your game idea and concept. Then you create your game design. Third, you start coding. Fourth, you do your player testing, focus group testing, and lastly, you release. Keep in mind that game dev phases are not set in stone. You are free to produce your own phases based on your workflow. Let's take a look at two different design choices. First is a grandiose Pong game, a very ambitious game, something we will not be doing in this series. Lastly, we will take a look at a portfolio-ready Pong game, and that is what we will be doing for this series. Now, you and a friend have been inspired by my series to tackle a Pong game at a size like no other for the purpose of selling on mobile phones. You, yourself, are an amazing programmer in only Godot and GDScript. Your friend is amazing in Photoshop and Spine 2D animation software, while only having basic knowledge of Unity and C#. Your game will have levels, story, music, and epic boss battles. On top of that, because your friend is an amazing artist, you will definitely have fancy and amazing art for your Pong game. Now, for a game this big, you need to start asking yourself lots of questions. Remember, the bigger the project, the more you have to put into your game idea and concept and game design phases. The first question to ask is, what kind of game are you making? And in this case, it's Pong inspired. After you've decided what type of game you are making, the next question to ask is, who is your target audience and how large are they? Now, keep in mind that understanding your target audience and how large they are gives you a rough estimate of how much money you are able to make. And this is because the only people interested in your game is your target audience. In this case, people who like stories, progressions, and Pong, because your game has stories, levels, and is Pong inspired. Now, after that, you have to decide what platform or platforms are you releasing for and or selling to. And this is important because different platforms have different requirements. For example, if you plan on selling on the Apple App Store, they require certain things from you versus if you were to sell on the Android Store, or in this case, the Google Play Store. And this is because different platforms have different requirements and are stricter than others on what is allowed on their store. The next question you need to ask yourself is, what game engine are you using? And that's because different game engines give you access to different tools and third-party software support or plugins. After that, ask yourself, does your game engine support exporting to your desired platforms? Now, in this case, this is up to you to research and figure out for yourself what your game engine can and cannot do. Just keep in mind that different game engines have different limitations. The more important thing you need to ask yourself is, does your game engine support your workflow? For example, Unity supports Spine 2D animation software exports. Creature animation software is available for the Godot game engine. On top of that, Godot does support GDScript and C#. However, Unity does not support GDScript. And on top of that, if you are exporting for HTML, Godot does not support C#. And so again, it is up to you in the game idea and concept phase to flesh out or figure out which game engine is best suited for your goals. Basically, this comes down to you and your friend. For example, your friend knows C#, and so perhaps it is a good choice or the better choice to start your project in the Godot game engine. Now, the reason Godot is a good choice is because the creature animation software is similar to Spine 2D, and therefore your friend, the artist, will most likely take 1 to 3 weeks to understand the creature application and get up and running. But what happens if your platform changes? For example, instead of making mobile games, perhaps you decide to export to HTML. Well, now you run into a problem. Because before, your friend could use creature animation software for 2D animations and code in C# for the Godot game engine, but now they have to learn GDScript because you are exporting to HTML, so perhaps it is a better idea to use Unity. Because since you are an amazing programmer, it will take you 1 to 3 weeks to understand C# and the Unity game engine versus your friend who has a basic understanding of C#, or in this case, perhaps even a limited understanding of C#, and now has to learn from scratch GDScript and everything Godot has to offer. So in this case, it's up to you and your friend. In this example, since GDScript is in fact an easier language to understand, it would most likely be beneficial to start your project in Godot and see where it goes from there. Since your game has a story, you need to also figure out what is your game and or story logline. Basically, in 2 to 3 sentences, you need to summarize your game and or story, and the logline helps you find direction in not only your game and story, but it also gives you an idea if your game does in fact sound fun. And since you do have a story, it is also in your interest to decide what the world of your game will look like. And this is basically world building. And in the basic world building stage, you are just trying to understand if your world makes sense for your game. The most important thing in the game idea and concept phase is understanding the risks. In this hypothetical, since you are selling your game on a mobile app store, you need to consider the risk with selling your game in certain app stores. For example, does the iOS app store deny apps for being copycat-like? Since you are making a Pong game, you are in a sense making a copycat game. And if you decide to sell on Android because it's a little easier to get your games through, there is also the risk that one day Android, or in this case the Google App Store, may start getting stricter. And lastly, it's always a good idea to understand how long your project may take. And you don't have to be perfect on this. Your best estimate is good enough. Once you are done with the first phase, it's time to move on to the second phase. And in this case, you are fleshing out your game design theory. For example, what are the goals for the game's audience? What are the deeper game design decisions for your game? And since you are making a story-based game, what is your story for this game? Now, once you figured out everything, do you start coding and drawing art? And for a project of this size, no. First, you need to see if your core concept is fun. What you need to do is create a basic game with no art and only simple shapes and numbers. And if art and or 3D models are needed, use only simple art with no colors. And this is called gray box prototyping. Now, what is gray box prototyping? Well, it's when your game or prototype only uses gray boxes inside of a gray world. If your game is fun with only gray boxes, then it will be amazing with all the fancy bling bling, which is your music, art, animation, dialogue, and so forth. Now, what exactly does your gray box prototype for your massive, ambitious game look like? Well, in this case, since you're making a Pong clone with multiple levels, it's just going to look like Pong. So in this case, you want your gray box prototype to look like Pong to see if Pong is still popular among an audience. And this is what we will be making in this series. Now again, we're making a portfolio-ready Pong game, which will showcase our skill as of now with what we know. And it's always good to have a portfolio because you can see your game projects evolve as your skill grows. For example, today you make Pong, but perhaps tomorrow you make a 2D adventure game. Now in this case, we're going to do the phases again. So first is the game idea and concept. So what are we making? We're making a Pong copycat game. Who is our audience? And it's basically for ourselves and perhaps maybe in the future for you, an interview. Now, more importantly, what platform will we be exporting our game to? And in this case, to keep it simple, we will export to HTML. HTML is very flexible. You can upload to itch.io. You can upload to a website specifically made for Godot games called gotm.io, or even perhaps your own website. And it is important to know which platform you will be exporting for, because different platforms have different upload requirements. Now, once we've decided a platform, we need to decide what game engine we will be using. And in this case, since we have only learned Godot up until this point, we will be making our game in Godot. Next, we need to ask ourselves, does Godot game engine support HTML export? And yes, Godot game engine does in fact support HTML exports. It's good enough for now, at least until Vulkan releases. And what I mean by that is that our HTML exports will only work with Firefox and Chrome. It will not work with Safari and Microsoft Edge. Next, let's ask ourselves, are there any risk for making a portfolio-ready Pong game? And the simple answer is no. Now, how long will it take to make this game? And on average, it should take 30 minutes to 2 hours. I'm bumping that estimation to 5 hours for very brand new beginner programmers. And it really depends on your level. For example, do you know what to use in the Godot game engine API? And on top of that, if you don't, you will most likely be using Google and the Godot documentation to look up for specific API classes to find solutions to your problems. Now, of course, my series will take longer than if you were to code this yourself, as I am or will be explaining code ideas and, of course, the refactoring at the end. Next, let's go ahead and take a look at game design. My personal advice is that it's always a good idea to draw out what you are making, because it's always good to create a visual for yourself to see the game design decisions you will need to make for your game. Also, keep in mind that nothing is set in stone. You can revisit game design and/or game ideas when you hit certain crossroads in your coding phase. And a project of this scale certainly does allow flexibility to go back into earlier phases. Now, in this case, I like to do 3 things. I like to list out game features into 3 categories. The first category is core game concept. The next is to do later, for example, towards the end of the project. And lastly, I like to have a list of things I want to do if I have time to do them. Basically, the last category is things I can live without if I do not have them in my game. So this is basically our game design, and that's basically it. We have a ball in the middle, 2 paddles, score in the middle of each player's side. But I like to go a little further. I like to actually draw out what things are doing. So for example, I like to ask questions as I draw. In this case, what is the ball doing? Ball does not move until a button is pressed. Okay, what happens when a button is pressed? Well, ball moves when a button is pressed, and as you can see here, the ball does bounce as it hits the horizontal lines of our screen, and then it stops when it hits a vertical line on our screen. Next, I will figure out how scoring works, and again, I like to draw it out. So in this case, we have 1-1, ball in the middle. When the ball hits a vertical side of the screen, it will give a point to the player on the opposite side of the screen, and vice versa, of course. But the most important thing is, how does the paddle interact with the ball, since Pong is all about connecting the paddle with the moving ball? And so in this case, I'll draw it out. So as you can see here, if the ball hits the top of our paddle, the ball moves upwards at a fast pace. If the ball hits the middle of our paddle, it moves straight at a slow pace. And of course, if it hits the edge of the bottom paddle, it will move downwards at a fast pace. Now, basically, game design is figuring out what the high risks are for the player and giving your player a high reward for taking that high risk, and figuring out what the low risks are for the player and giving them a low reward. Basically, you want to incentivize players to take risks, and in this case, it's harder to win a game with a slow-moving ball that moves in a straight line. Now, since we are using AI, this gives the AI a chance to catch up to the moving ball. Now, the concept of this is quite simple. The closer we are to the top or the bottom of our paddle, the closer the player is to missing contact with the ball, and therefore there is a high risk at play. Now, if the player does make contact with the ball at the edges of the paddle, we give that player a high reward by basically moving the ball at a faster pace. Now, if the player tries to make contact with the ball towards the middle of the paddle, there's a lot of area the player can work with, and therefore it's harder to miss the ball when the player is aiming to make contact with the ball at the middle of the paddle. Therefore, because it's easier to make contact with the ball at the middle of the paddle, it is considered low risk, and therefore the player is given a low reward. And in this case, the ball moves straight at a slow pace. Now again, I like to list them out. So in this case, I list out the core features. So one player paddle, one AI paddle as opponent that chases after the ball. Game states to allow player more control over when the ball is served or when the game starts. Paddles can move vertically, but not horizontally. Paddles cannot move beyond the screen. On top of that, ball changes direction when it touches horizontal lines. Game point is over when ball touches vertical line of the screen, and point given to the paddle on the opposite side of the screen. Basically, the losing player gets to serve the ball. And when game reaches 3 points, game is over. Player has the ability to restart the match. Now, on my to-do list, I have background music and sound effects, and these are things I want to do towards the end of making the game. And lastly, I do have a want-to-have section. My game doesn't need it, but if I have time, I'll go ahead and do them. And in this case, I have three things. The first is a main menu with a simple start game button. The next screen will be an AI difficulty level menu. So you can choose the paddle to chase the ball slowly, faster, and basically at the same Y coordinate as the ball, which is the impossible. And lastly, maybe the game plays better if there is a compounding ball speed. Basically, the ball gets faster over time. And again, nothing is set in stone. We can always revisit our phases to change what we need if we don't like certain things as we are coding along. Thank you for subscribing, and thank you for clicking the like button. In the next episode, we will start taking a look at coding our Pong game. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.